If you do that, Jesus will return in the next 24 hours. You'll be rejoicing. Despite this question, actually, the cause of despair. But for others, Jesus has a hope. Jesus has a lot to say about the Lord in heaven. King Nebuchadnezzar took this to the alligators. So he got to the alligators, which he went to Revelation, just close to the alligators, which is junk. Now, the King of Revelation is apocalypse. There you go, it's an apocalypse. And he is to expose what is written. And what the Lord will take as a leaf when he covers and he retrieves, our minds will never grasp all the situation. So Revelation means to uncover what is written from the human mind. Another verse related to that is in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 7. In the previous verse, it tells us this. Surely the Lord granted us nothing. Unless he reveals his secret to the civilians, to the servant, the prophet. In other words, the Lord takes Jesus to declare his truth. Because our minds will not be able to grasp it otherwise. Now, you discover, I'm sure, if you have read the book of Revelation, that there are many symbolic pictures in this book. But this does not really best describe in our world. Our symbolic language does not give us the license to depart from the normal rules of interpretation. It's because we symbolic elements to the book of Revelation that give us the license to spiritual interpretations. So in this series, we will interpret Revelation literally, while at the same time respecting the symbolic features of the book. What is the symbolic feature point to? But I do point to a rule that I have not yet accepted in the future of the story of the Revelation. The world has never known to us what must be for grace. The word must means a certain future event or occur is going to demonstrate what might take place, or what means to take place, but it's what must seem to take place, which means we are supposed to occur because we are decreed by God. Now notice that I can't say Christ, but it's by sin. The events will occur by sin. It's been over 2,000 years since the flood was prophesied. All occurred during the 40 years of righteousness to take place. In fact, some commentators suggest that John was prepared by saying this. But he believes that it was going to happen in his lifetime. Other commentators say that this happened in 70 AD. But how could John say that he was in for his birth in 2,000 years? Well, it is true that we need to be meek. We have no time to sin for our purposes. The Greek word for sin is kato, or the word from decameter, which means it might be falsehood. And so the first reading for sin is that once only tribulations begin, then they will take place very quickly. Once the clock starts, the events happen rapidly. It is happening at the church. For example, if we go to Luke chapter 18, where this word chapter was used, and here is the context of the Christian Genesis 4, and it was in the class, and it's finished where they are, and finally, it's But notice, those who heal and injustice deplore. And where does one read it? But make it heal. And notice, the blessing comes not by reading, not even by hearing, the blessing comes by the doing.
John is giving us a paraphrase of the sacred name of God.
but many that is unpronounceable. This disclosed to Moses when he was called by God at the burning bush to free the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. The most loving dialogue with God, he said, well, what happens if the Israelites ask me to get that essentially resistant to Jesus to them? What is their meaning? And in Exodus 3:14, God said, among I am who I am, that's the sacred name of God. And he said, just as the sacred sons of Israel, I am, and I sent me to you. And that's the same name that John is using. In Revelation, God is the God of eternity past. He is the God of the present time. He is the God of eternal future. And the sovereign Lord, he is with us in every crisis that we face. So, the source of blessing comes from a threefold source, the eternal God. In his fullness, and also from the Lord Jesus in his threefold office as prophet, priest, and king in verse 5 and from Jesus Christ, the blessing, the Son Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. In his life, Jesus was a faithful witness for God. He declared God's love, God's righteousness, God's glory, God's will, he declared to the world. Faithful witness speaks to his office as prophet. For example, in Acts chapter 3, he appeals telling the Jewish people that he is indeed the fulfillment of Messianic prophecy. Acts 3:22, Moses said, the Lord God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your brethren. You hear me shortly to you, to everything says to you. Peter's referring to saying that verse is speaking about the Lord Jesus, who is the prophet. And so, faithful witness, he first was offered his prophet's firstborn from the dead. Jesus was first in time. He was first in importance. He was also the firstborn from the dead. And what that means is that he is the first to be resurrected, and many, many, many will follow in the resurrection. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that great chapter of the resurrection, he says in verse 20, but now Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits. But those who are asleep, in other words, he will be the first to rise, and then many who believe in him will follow in his resurrection. But also, the firstborn from the dead speaks to Jesus' present priestly office as a high priest. He was raised from the dead, ascended to heaven, and now sits at the right hand of God the Father, interceding for you and I. As a high priest, he's the firstborn from the dead, speaks to his priestly office, and ruler of the kings of the earth, speaks to his future ministry. In his past, Jesus was a faithful prophet. In his present ministry, he is a high priest. And in his future ministry, he will rule over the nations of the earth as the true Davidic king. That's something we will be exploring and discovering as we work our way through Revelation. But let's go to Psalm 89. I believe John is referring to Psalm 89 in a lot of these two verses, because we see in Psalm 89 that he is the first fruit. Psalm 89, verse 27.
I will also make him my firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth.
This is your son. The Lord Jesus has ruled the nations. Now, even now, Jesus sitting at the right hand of God the Father as our high priest. Even now, he is above all power. Even now, he's King of kings and Lord of lords. He's sitting on the throne at the right hand of God the Father, but that is not the Davidic throne. One day, his throne will be on earth. And we will reign with him. In Revelation 20, verse 4, you know what it says in Revelation 20, verse 4, the very end of the passage, it says that they came to life, that's the believers, that resurrection, and it says, and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. And so we will one day reign with this Lord, with this great King. So the book of Revelation, in this book, the Lord has made known to us what must take place. And we see that there is a blessing for those who obey the precepts of the book. And we see that the blessing comes from a threefold source, the eternal God, the Spirit in His fullness, and from the Lord Jesus in His threefold office as prophet, priest, and king. And then, in verse 5, it says, continuously loves us and released us from our sins by His blood, and has made us to be in kingdom, priests to His God and Father, to Him be glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. And here in this law, the Lord Jesus justified us and He equipped us. The very loves us, and in the present tense, it doesn't say to Him who loved us, it says to Him who loves us. There is never a time in Jesus' eternal existence where He does not love. His love is in the present tense. His love is in the abiding life. His love endures into the future. But despite our suffering, trials, tests, and distresses we may face, the love of the Lord Jesus is with us through it. And it is love that led Jesus to the cross, and it is the same love that extends from the cross. That is here that the one who loves us also released us from our sins. And He released us from our sins by His blood. And because of His atoning work, sin no longer holds us captive. At the price of His blood, we are released from the penalty of sin, that's what it means to be justified. At the price of His blood, we are released from the power of sin, that's what it means to be sanctified. And having been rescued from sin, the Lord Jesus equipped us to be a king, a priest. Corporately, we are a kingdom because God reigns over us, but individually, we are priests because we are set apart to serve the Lord according to spiritual gifts and in the power of the Spirit. In fact, John is probably alluding to the role that Israel had, and I believe still does, to a large extent, when they were called to be God's people in the wilderness. In Exodus chapter 19, verse 3, it says, "And you shall be to me a kingdom of priests, a holy nation." That was their calling. And that is also the calling that we have as believers, to be a kingdom of priests. Priests are what we are now, and kings are what we will one day become. And then in verse 7,
Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him, so it is to be. Amen. Jesus will return to earth the same way he left. We read about how he left in the book of Acts, chapter 1. He left in a cloud. Now, this is not a normal cloud, but like a cloud we see in the sky coming down and bending Jesus with his command. And it's just between us. The cloud of divine glory. It is the same cloud that covered the tent of meeting during Israel's desert wilderness. It is the same cloud that enclosed the disciples on the Mount of Transfiguration. And so when Jesus returns, he will be wrapped in a cloud of divine glory. And as we turn, in this case, it's not for his church, that will occur at the rapture, and we will be talking about that. His return is to bring about justice and establish his reign. In fact, we see an image of his return in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on it is called Faithful and True. This is referring to Jesus. And the righteousness of judges and righteousness. So not many doubt whether Jesus is the Messiah. But there is a day coming when the entire world will see his return and will no longer be in death. All people living at that time will mourn at his return, as it says here. Some will mourn in regret because of the dreadful judgment that is about to come on them. Take us to Revelation chapter 6. Verse 1 says, "And the kings of the earth, great men and commanders, verse 15, and the rich and the strong, and every slave and free man, that is, they're all going to raise, put themselves in the caves and among the rocks of the mountains, and they said to the mountains and to the rocks, fall on us. And hide us from the presence of the angels, sit from the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb, for the great day of their wrath has come, and he is able to stand." There's no repentance there. There's regret. There's regret because of the dreadful judgment that is about to come. And so there's mourning because of that. But then others will mourn in repentance because they will finally grasp that the death of Jesus is the existence. Even though he keeps it. And as a result, they will return to the Messiah who died for sin. I believe what John is telling us here is that on the whole, in general, the Gentile nations will mourn and regret, while on the whole, in general, the nation of Israel will mourn in repentance. One last verse before we conclude. John is alluding to a verse from Zechariah chapter 12. Written 9 and 10. And notice what he says, "In that day I was set about to destroy the nations of the friends of the Gentile nations that have come against Jerusalem. And then I will pour out on the house of David and on the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and supplication, so that they will look on me when they have tears, and they will mourn for him." This is a mourning that has been inspired, if you can call it that, again, initiated by the spirit of grace and supplication. They will mourn for him as one mourns for an only son, and they will weep bitterly over him, like they were weeping over his brothers in the morning and repentance. They will recognize that the woman is pierced. They will suffer. They will suffer. And so when Jesus returns, they will be mourning. Many will mourn regret because of the judgment that's coming, and others, particularly the nation of Israel, will mourn even through repentance.
some strong conclusions just from my sources, from my education here. Jesus said, I will be out from you in the earth. That's the beginning and the end of the new gospel. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord, who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. Here the Lord is the Son, holding of all wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. And so we can trust Him. In the time of crisis, the Lord intervenes with unrestricted power and infinite love, because He is Almighty, unrestricted power. So we can call out to Him in the time of trouble. And so here's what I want us to do for this week. I can begin my series of adoration. I want us to spend time this week in prayer. Pray that we might have ears to hear what the Lord is saying for us. Spend some time in your own personal devotion. Praying that we might be empowered not only to hear what the Lord is saying to us, but to obey what He's saying to us, because He's drawn those three. We will receive this promised blessing. And thirdly, as we prepare for going through the book of Revelation, it's through the prayer that this word may cause praise to well up and deepen in its source the great hope that we have in Christ Jesus. And so I'm talking to prayer about it because of prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for the future that you have. In many ways, it is fairly frightening. But in other ways, it is full of hope because we know that in the end, your righteousness will be there. That in the end, you will be the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. For our great hope that you've given to us, Lord Jesus, not only hope for now, but also for the future. And Lord, I pray that as we work our way through this series, that those who generally such incredible hope on us, because we know that our future in you is a glorious future. Pray in the same way, Lord, as we look to the hope that lies ahead. Let us pray as well, Lord, as we experience what is happening even now. That we would sense that you are trusted to stay here. That you would never come into your existence where you can help us. But that we would know your heart. And that we would have the strength to endure the things that we have to go through. And even in that. And so, Lord, we commit this series to you. And I do pray, Lord, that as we do, I do pray you give us help to pray. And I do pray, Lord, that our souls will dwell with praise. Bless these things in your name, Jesus, and for your grace.